Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. We thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for the opportunity to worship together as a group and to come together in an assembly. We ask that you would open our hearts and our minds to you this morning to hear your word and to give our praise to you as a living sacrifice. Thank you and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Lord, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Lord, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great. Your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Lord, I'll worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Lord, I'll worship your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Your love is surprising, I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this love song rising up in me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Well, good morning. Welcome. Good morning. I am Lindsay Ballazer. I'm the engagement coordinator here. I oversee life groups and community life events here. We'd like to offer a special welcome to our newcomers, and here are a few things you might find helpful. First, we have a welcome booklet. It's available at the church welcome station near the front doors that way. It talks about the church's vision and values and will help you get to know us. After the sermon, we'll take an offering, and if you're here for the first time, please look in the back of the seat in front of you for the guest info card, which is right here. And write down whatever information you're willing to share with us. This helps us to welcome you in a more personal way. And if you bring your filled out welcome card to the welcome station in the lobby, we'll give you a Starbucks card. So that's an extra bonus, and you can enjoy a coffee or tea on us. And if you just want to fill it in and put it in the offering plate, you're welcome to do that as well, and you'll still get a CD either way. So, along with the welcome card, you'll notice a giving card and a prayer card. The giving card provides information on how to give to the church and includes a checkbox if you want to find more information online for giving options there. The prayer card allows you to make prayer requests to offer thanks to God for some blessings, and each week our staff prays for these requests at our staff meeting. So place any or all of these cards in the offering bag as they are passed after the sermon. Now we're going to take a moment to highlight a few of our upcoming events. More details on each are in the bulletin that you might have picked up in the front door. It's right here. So please be sure to check this out if you have that for more. Of the flowers and send them home with the helpers. So we'd love for you and your family to come join us after the service. Enjoy the sunshine, beautiful outdoors, and we'll have lemonade and snacks for that. Upcoming high school ride to hell for grades 9 to 12, Saturday, August 15th. Meet us at the church with your bike at 12:15 to Blackbridge for a 24-mile ride round trip to hell. Bring bike, money for ice cream, and a side to share at the cookout at the Humphreys. Questions or you need directions, contact Nigel. He's our youth ministry director. Open board meeting on Sunday, August 23rd at 12:15 in room C1. We will have a meeting to discuss the 2015-2016 budget proposal and bylaw reviews. So stay after the service that day. Vineyard Day of Service. This is August 30th. We'd love for you to join us for our first ever day of service. There's lots of little projects around here that would be awesome to have you join in with each of your skills. After the celebration, we'll meet in the cafe for pizza and then split into groups for assigned tasks. Sign up and get more information, and if you do have a special skill, please sign up. We've got a place for you to write that in the sign up. So now we have an extra special day here. We're going to dedicate Nigel and Tina's daughter, Seidel, Barry. So I'd like to invite the family to come up here. A couple words about dedication here at the Vineyard. Every human life is a gift from God. In the Psalms, the scripture says, "Don't you see that children are God's best gift, the fruit of the womb, his generous legacy?" In response to this gift and his legacy, God's people over time have honored God by dedicating their children to his purposes. We find this also in the story of Jesus. He was dedicated to the temple on the eighth day. We believe that children, in fact, belong to God and are entrusted to us for a season, and it's a call for us to love and to protect, to challenge and to gradually but steadily release them, to release these precious children. It requires every resource we have. God is there all along the way of a child's growth, and the resources are there for asking. So we're dedicating, I'm going to come down here. We are dedicating Seidel Kate Berry this morning, who was born on December 4th. Right? Wait, where's my notes? Okay. A birthday twin with Nigel, and probably the best birthday gift for him and everybody. So welcome, all of you. This is so beautiful to have you here. I was thinking, after you guys asked me to dedicate Seidel, and I just had the sweetest image of how special God uses, or how special it is the way God uses our kids to speak to us and show himself. And I couldn't help remember what it's like to come into having two, and especially two little ones, and what a tiring but very precious time it is. And those moments where Cora is playing with Seidel And there's this like sisterly love that you can't help but know is just unbelievable gift from God. And then there's moments where, you know, Saito will roll over, or maybe she's starting to crawl or trying to stand. You can almost experience God's grace and his patience and love for us. And then, of course, in those moments when, you know, discipline is necessary, and everything inside of you would react. The timing is critical, right? No, just kidding. No, not necessary now. and you might want to react with a strong hand, but there's something about God's grace and mercy that you experience in that moment that you just know what your daughter needs more than anything is a hug. And God is brilliant at shaping us as parents and shaping our children and intertwining that story, that beautiful story. So today you've brought your precious daughter before this community of friends and family who get to share in this story, to dedicate her to the Lord and to dedicate yourselves for the task of parenting. So I have a few questions here for you. Will you pledge to support and love Seidel by providing her with the opportunity to grow up in a family of faith with the hope that she will one day come to know Jesus as her own teacher, Lord, and Savior? Okay. In dedicating Seidel, you are, to the best of your ability and with God's help, committing to providing a loving family environment which Seidel can grow in love, loyalty, and obedience to God. In dedicating Seidel, you are, to the best of your ability and with God's help, to encourage Seidel to grow in faith, that she might be received in the fellowship of the church, fully partaking in the work and the worship of this faith community. To the family, will you love and encourage as you come alongside Nigel and Tina in this awesome responsibility of raising Seidel? And congregation, will you support and help them raise Seidel in our community? Now, I have a prayer here. Would she be better in your arms, or would it be okay if I were to hold her here? Go for it. Okay. All right. Oh, dear. This is such a treat. Oh, wait, sweet girl. Gracious Father, thank you for this precious child. She's a gift to her family and to our community. Today we pray that she will grow up to know you, love you, and serve you, that she would be free to be who you have made her to be. Give Nigel and Tina wisdom to care for this child who you have entrusted to them. Show them more of who you are as they love and care for this precious daughter. Bless their families with many chances to love Seidel, to share in her laughter, which is its own gift, her joy, and to support Nigel and Tina, and to be there through the hard times as well. Sweet, beautiful Seidel, I dedicate you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. There she is.
Lizzie, yeah. High five. Love it. Okay, at this point, if you are in fifth through eighth grade, you are dismissed on my right-hand side. Head back to the youth room, hang out this morning. If you have a cell phone on your person this morning, if you could turn that to silent, that would be excellent so we don't have phone calls. That can be wildly distracting, not always in the best way. However, if you're going to play on Facebook or Twitter this morning and live tweet the sermon or anything that's happening this morning, full permission to go ahead with that. Have a great time. Finally, if you do have a fussy child, as we frequently do, we do have a nursing mom station to my right-hand side for nursing mothers. We also have a lobby out in front where we broadcast the sermon, and you can see and hear the sermon out there as well. Man, won't it be fun when I have two kids that can run? Y'all are in so much trouble. I'll apologize in advance for that. But my name is Nigel Berry. I am the Youth Ministries Director here at the church. Pastor Donnell is on a staycation this week, so he is going to do lovely things like yard work and sleeping in, I hope, getting some much-deserved time off. So I'm filling in his stead today. He'll be back preaching next Sunday. So while I'm getting everything set up today, if you'd like to grab sermon notes, they're available on the cart, which is down here on the ground floor, right below the middle section. Grab notes for the sermon. You can also grab the scripture there, coloring pages if you like to color. We like to keep everybody well engaged to the best of our ability. So today we're going to be finishing up a sermon series. So we started a five-part series 4 weeks ago on the parables of Jesus. So we titled this series "The Parables of" Stories of Us Rediscovering the Parables of Jesus. And so we're going to conclude that today. And Pastor Donnell and I have really enjoyed this series for several reasons. One, we both enjoy hearing stories. We think stories are fascinating. We both are avid listeners to NPR and really enjoy a lot of that programming, love storytelling. We find it really amusing. We find it touching. And we enjoy telling stories as well. And in addition to hearing stories and telling stories, I especially enjoy getting to live out my own story, my story as a father, as a husband, as a pastor, as a friend, all these different hats that I get to wear. I live that story out every day, and it's always, always an adventure. And that's because we believe that stories are central to who we are. Stories are absolutely fundamental at our core of our being. They shape our histories, they inform our futures, and stories affect us to different degrees of importance. Some stories we find to be entertaining. Other tales are meant to be more cautionary. And some stories provide us with astute architectural advice. There we go. But the story we're going to close with in our series this morning, perhaps one of the most significant stories that we have in describing God, humanity, and our relationship with one another. And it's going to be a story about food. Who doesn't love food? Oh, that was my last sermon. Can we get the next one? More like a banquet or a feast. Try again. Let's do like Christmas dinner. There we go. That's what we wanted. Yahtzee. So the Messianic Banquet is what we're going to start off exploring this morning. I'm going to spend a little bit more time today setting this story, this Jesus story up in Luke 14 by backing up and talking about this Messianic Banquet story, because this was a really, really big story, and it impacts and lays a lot of the groundwork for what Jesus talks about later on. And so it's our introduction to the idea of a Messianic Banquet. Messianic simply is a word used to describe anything that has to do with the Jewish Messiah. And remember that the Jewish Messiah was a person who was foretold to be a savior of the nation state of Israel. They're going to defend and rescue the nation. And the Bible's prophetic writings put strong emphasis on a singular Messiah. And this is one of these stories that describes the work of that Messiah. Isaiah spoke saying, "The Lord of hosts will prepare a lavish banquet for all peoples on this mountain, a banquet of aged wine, choice pieces with marrow, and refined aged wine." See, he got the wine in there twice. Guy's such a lush. Love him. "And on this mountain he will swallow up the covering which is over all peoples, even the veil which is stretched over all nations. He will swallow up death for all time, and the Lord God will wipe tears away from all faces. He will remove the reproach of his people from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken, and it will be said in that day, behold, this is our God for whom we have waited, that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation." Now what we need to do as we dive into the weight of this story is to recall two very important realities about the ancient Near East cultures. First, we need to remember that this was an age before emails, chat rooms, Facebook, and even long before the printing press. Consequently, stories did not have to be long for them to be good. Nor did they have to be complex for them to carry significance. And this is different from our way of thinking today. Most of our expectations when we see bestsellers coming up on all the New York Times bestseller list or whatever list we're looking at, we're looking at novels, usually several hundred pages long, big stories. And on top of stories that are several hundred pages long, we also are really into sequels right now. We're into prequels, we're into trilogies, anthologies. We just compound these stories, make them bigger and grander and greater and longer. And the idea of a short story is kind of missed in our culture. Usually our short story engagement starts right about the time we begin to read and doesn't really get explored much more unless you study advanced literature degrees. We tend to look at longer stories. And on top of this difference, the ancient Near East was an oral culture. Very few people were able to read or to write. Those that were very limited in the resources that they had to read and the resources that they had to write. So consequently, they talked a lot more than even we talk today. And they told stories.
And they told the same stories over and over and over, particularly the good ones, like this story of a messianic banquet. And so the shorter the story, the simpler it was to remember, to share, and to wrestle with. Now, second thing that's good to know is that it's helpful to understand that the stories of this culture permeated the culture and the very identity of the Jewish people. The best analogy I could come up with was the idea of our Revolutionary War here in the United States, and that our Revolutionary War actually framed a lot of our mentality as Americans. And so speaking as American, looking at some of the implications, I wonder if a lot of our independence within our own culture is actually one of the positives that came out of this chapter of our history. Americans tend to be very independent. We're hardworking, we're focused, and the pursuit of a dream is really praiseworthy in our culture. But there's a flip side to this coin, too. Some of this independence has actually alienated us from other people. Across the board, Americans tend to be really lonely. Researchers at Brigham Young University published findings in the Perspectives on Psychological Science journal this spring, which suggests that 1 in 5 Americans actively struggles with loneliness. And the consequences of that are really incredible. Part of this report suggests that the toll of prolonged loneliness on the human body is that it can decrease life expectancy by up to 14%. And that's the conservative estimate. And that shouldn't really surprise us, because chronic loneliness also increases our risk of heart disease and depression. And that damage, by some estimates, is a greater threat to our health than obesity. Right? So I want you to think about that for just a minute. Being alone is likely to be more detrimental to our health than Taco Bell. Let that sit. Let that sit with you this morning. This is a scary reality. Loneliness is a greater threat to us than obesity in America. The other side of our coin, our history, our narrative defines us. We get some good with it, we get some bad with it. This story of Isaiah was a defining part of the Jewish identity. You see, the Messianic banquet is a story of life and of provision. Two things that were not guaranteed in these times. Wars and violence were rampant. Child mortality was through the roof by even how we could comprehend that today. Life was not a guarantee. They were far more intimate with death in their daily lives than most of us are. Another thing, too, was the idea of excess. Was a very foreign idea. They were dependent on the crops, the seasons, to provide food for their family. It was never guaranteed that you were going to have food on your table from one season to the next. In fact, desperation grew so much that the Bible and other ancient literature records people actually sacrificing their children, murdering their children for the sake of rain. That's desperation. And that was a reality for our ancient Near East. And so when you have the story of a messianic banquet, a God that is providing life and food in plenty forever, this is a good story. This is the best possible story you could hope for. This is brilliant. And so this became a part of the stories shared at the tables, shared around the dinner tables, shared on the shores of the lake, talking about this story, imagining it, wrestling with it, asking questions. When is this banquet going to be? How do I get there? What's for dinner? What is a world like without death? Or a world like where nobody cries? Can you imagine that? I think that's one of the reasons this story has so much draw, is there's so much into it, so many questions, so much wonder that the story persisted. It was a good story. The story carried hope, it carried promise, and it carried a sense of inevitable justice against the things in life that are just plain wrong. But even the best of news can be lost with translation. And poor translations aren't unfamiliar to us today. We can see this plenty of times in our culture. World around us has plenty of examples. Sometimes words can be translated poorly, like this t-shirt that was printed overseas. I don't know what toilet love is, but I don't want it. We also see mistranslation occurring in symbols. Another rather unfortunate one. And there is always potential for epic disaster when communicating with bad information. Don't you ever do that, my daughter will grab it. Even the best of stories can fall into the trap of misinterpretation, and sometimes the consequences are truly unfortunate. And sadly, this was the fate that was to befall Isaiah's banquet story. So here's what happened. A significant part of the Jewish nation's history was their conquering and subsequent exile to Babylon. They were permitted to return home years later, but while returning from exile, the majority of people had begun to speak Aramaic as a first language and Hebrew as a second. So naturally, as you come home, you start to bring this new part of your culture into your old culture, and they mix together. And so what they ended up doing was creating a document called the Babylonian Talmud. And the Talmud took parts of the Hebrew scriptures, retranslated it into Aramaic, broke it apart into bits and pieces, and then added commentary. It was a hubbub of Jewish thought, theology, questions, ideas, all wrapped up into a document which greatly influenced the Jewish temple and the Jewish religious leaders, all the way through the time of Jesus. And so when we look back at Isaiah's translation from Hebrew to Aramaic, mixed in with all this thought, this is how it shifted. The translation read like this: Yahweh of hosts will make for all peoples in the mountain a meal. And although they suppose it is an honor, it will be a shame for them and great plagues, plagues from which they will be unable to escape, plagues whereby they will come to their end. You can imagine this translation wasn't very popular. The story shifts from a God of healing and care to a God of destruction, who pulls the rug out on people. And so now our stories are sitting in contrast with one another. What do you do with that? Well, time goes on, and there were two other stories that eventually began to influence this larger banquet picture. The first was from a book called the Book of Enoch, which was written about 300 years before the time of Jesus. And Enoch gets mentioned briefly in Genesis 4, and he is the great-grandfather of Moses. Now, the Book of Enoch is considered to be a fictionalized story of Enoch by most Orthodox Jews, and is now regarded as an important but non-inspired example of ancient literature. And so, describing this messianic banquet, Enoch, their story reads like this: The angels of punishment will take them, the unrighteous, so that they may repay them for the wrong they did to his children and to his chosen ones. And they will become a spectacle to the righteous and to his chosen ones. They will rejoice over them, for the anger of the Lord of Spirits will rest upon them, and the sword of the Lord of Spirits will be drunk with them. And the righteous and the chosen will be saved on that day, and they will never see the faces of the sinners and the lawless from then on. And the Lord of Spirits will remain over them and with them, so that the Son of Man may dwell and eat and lie down and rise up forever and ever. Whew. So now, instead of the rug being pulled out on everybody, the righteous get to remain while the unrighteous are butchered for spectacle. That took a twist. And so that complicates the story even more. So now the righteous inherit the banquet and the unrighteous are cast out. The final text which influenced the story at this time came from the community of believers at Qumran, who is a kind of desert tribe studying the scriptures, separate in authority and influence from the temple leaders at the time. You've heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls that were discovered several years ago. They came from this community. And one of the Dead Sea Scrolls was called the Messianic Scroll. And part of that Messianic Scroll talks about this banquet. And there's, again, this contrast that was very popular at this time. The portion translated from the Messianic Scroll says that the Messiah of Israel shall come, and the chiefs of the clans of Israel shall sit before him, each in the order of his dignity, according to his place in their camps and marches. And it rejected those that may be smitten in his flesh, or paralyzed in his feet or hands, or lame, or blind, or deaf, or dumb, or smitten in his flesh with a visible blemish. Good heavens. This story is nothing like the story we first read in Isaiah now. Not only do we have distinctions between righteous and unrighteous, who can come, who cannot, now there are more distinctions so that if any part of you is not ideal, you're now on the outside. And those who get to come in are now scrapping for the best seats at the banquet. Oh, this just got crazy, y'all. So it's at this point in time that the scales have been largely tipped. The messianic banquet was no longer good news for everyone. It was good news for the good people, the righteous, the perfect. And everybody else was to be rejected. So now finally, with all this background in place, we can catch up with Jesus in Luke chapter 14, where Jesus is about to enter into a conversation about cows and food and neighbors, and it's going to be amazing. I love this. So I'm going to confess to you real quick. I've been nerding out a little bit with my Netflix time. I've been watching the new series on Netflix, Daredevil, based on the Marvel superhero. Anybody watching that right now? You? It's dark, but it's so good. I love this. And so as I was watching the episode this week, there's a quote that stuck out to me, especially as it relates to our conversation this morning. And the quote reads, "You don't get to be the man on top without making enemies looking to tear you down." And this summarizes the story of Jesus perfectly by Luke 14. Jesus was at the top of his game at this point in the story. He was growing in his reputation. He was growing in his fame. And our story starts by seeing him invited to essentially a celebrity's home for dinner. And at this point, they're trying to figure Jesus out. Is this guy with us or is this guy against us? What do we do with this Jesus person? We don't have him figured out yet. He's got an impressive reputation at this point. He's been healing people, casting out demons, teaching with really unusual wisdom, building huge crowds of followers, raised a dead girl to life. We take Luke and his story of Jesus chronologically, he's got a pretty impressive resume built at this point. So now they're trying to figure out what to do with Jesus. So they test him, and here's where our story begins. One Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. Sounds fun already, right? There in front of him was a man suffering from abnormal swelling of his body. And Jesus asked the Pharisees and experts in the law, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not?" But they remained silent. So taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him on his way. Then he asked them, "If one of you has a child, or let's say an ox, that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, wouldn't you pull it out?" And they had nothing to say. Well, this party's already getting awkward. A party where nobody is talking, laughing, living it up, is not a party. This is just weird. Silent, stony focus. I feel awkward describing it to you. And so Jesus takes it a step further. And here's what I love about Jesus. When everything is awkward, Jesus does the most awkward thing that he can do by saying something awkward. Is everybody familiar with Abraham Lincoln? Not the president, the icebreaker. See, this has served me well in the past. When you find yourself in a really awkward situation and there's that just like drop, you're supposed to say Abraham Lincoln out loud. And the idea is that it just releases the tension. It distracts from whatever was awkward, whatever was weird, and you think about Abraham Lincoln. And see, and Jesus doesn't even insert a Father Abraham into this conversation, let alone an Abraham Lincoln. He leans into the situation even more and just builds on the awkward. And so our story continues. When he noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. "When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come to say to you, 'Give this person your seat,' and then humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, 'Friend, move up to a better place.' Then you will be honored in the presence of all the other guests. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." Then Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." And so at this point, a man at the table just snaps. He's had it. He's done. He can't take it anymore. Jesus did the weird thing where he acknowledged a weird thing, and then on top of that, he offered a correction to his host, which was so weird. And this guy just wants to get out of there. He wants to finish testing Jesus, make up his mind, and leave. And so the man makes this statement. He says, "Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God." And the trap has been set. Because at the time, it was customary to reply to specific statements with another specific statement. And so that was the man's test. It's similar in our culture how we'll ask somebody how they're doing, sometimes as a courtesy, but not actually as a curiosity, right? So we do this with, like, people at the checkout lines in the grocery store or our bank tellers. And the way it flows in our culture is to say, "How are you?" They say, "I'm fine. How are you?" And then you say, "I'm good, thanks." And you move on. And in our culture, it's weird if you ask somebody how they're doing and they actually tell you. Anybody have this happen? And as they're telling you, you're kind of thinking in the back of your mind, "Why are you telling me this? This is so weird. I didn't need to know that." And that's just a cultural misfire. See, the question is more sincere if we're asking our close friends or a close family, but when we ask a stranger, it's more of a protocol. And so, in a similar way, this is how the test was being set up for Jesus. He was asked the protocol to see if he would reply appropriately. And the idea was that Jesus was going to reply with something saying, "Oh, that we might one day sit at the banquet and be counted as worthy of God's favor." And that would be about an appropriate reply. The idea that they get to be in, people who are out of favor get to be out, and they would have passed the test. The way to be an insider was to play by the rules and to identify yourself as an insider while affirming that they're outsiders. That's the test. Associate with us, don't associate with them. And in good fashion, Jesus proudly serves as our Pope of Nope and refuses to go along. So here's one of the things I find to be consistent about Jesus, something I've grown to appreciate. In addition to being a Pope of Nope, Jesus has a constant ability to open us up to new revelations, new perspectives that shape us into better reflections of God's image. And so as the trap is laid to test Jesus, he offers a reply that would have been very surprising, if not distressful, to the party guests. And he replies with a story. And this is the story Jesus tells. "A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, 'Come, for now everything is ready.' But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said, 'I've just bought a field, and I must go and see it. Please excuse me.' Another said, 'I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me.' Still another said, 'I just got married. I can't come.' So the servant came back and reported this to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, 'Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame.' 'Sir,' the servant said, 'what you have ordered has been done, but there's still room.' Then the master told his servant, 'Go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet.'" And this parable tells us a lot about God, his kingdom, and a lot about us. Those who had previously RSVP'd shamefully backed out of the banquet prepared for them, using the worst possible excuses. No one would have bought land without seeing it first. No one. And nobody would invest in working animals if they did not know the quality of their investment. And this last guy, did he just do like a shotgun wedding in Vegas? Like, how did he not know he was getting married? He RSVPs yes, be like, oh, I forgot, I'm getting hitched. Really? Come on. At the end of the day, the excuses are just insulting. They're painful excuses. And so it's no wonder that the host was angry. I would have been furious. And what I couldn't stuff into my freezer, I might have just dumped angrily into the trash, along with the tattered remains of my friendships. Because what an insult. But the host does something unexpected. The banquet is so good. The banquet is so valuable, so meaningful, that a few rotten replies aren't going to stop this party. He sends his servant out to bring in everyone else. And that's because this parable is ultimately about restoration. Jesus masterfully reclaims Isaiah's vision of the messianic banquet, inviting everyone back into the promise. And it's a remarkable story in every sense. Jesus failed the test of the Pharisees, but he reclaimed the narrative of his nation. What do we do with the story now? Well, if you're just joining us for the first time, or you've been out and about this summer, we're ending our series on the parables of Jesus this morning. And it's a funny thing to say out loud that we're ending our series on the parables of Jesus, because these are stories that have persisted for thousands of years. And they don't actually end. Good stories keep on getting told over and over. So it's funny to say we're closing, because the reality is these are always going to show back up. They're good stories. They're powerful stories. But they're only going to be powerful if we allow ourselves to enter into them. See, our approach to narrative, to stories, has been to approach the biblical stories seeking transformation rather than just information. There's no doubt that stories can tell us things, but wisdom has shown us that if we only pursue the point of the story, sometimes we miss the power of the actual story itself. Once a story has been broken down into bullet points or a checklist of takeaways, the story ceases to be alive. It's no longer interesting. You got the point. You got the cliff notes. Why reread it? I think that's one of the reasons we struggle to take time and to actually read the scriptures on our own. Because I believe that the church possesses a living piece of literature to guide us closer to the very heart and presence of God, then reading it should go both ways. The scriptures would explore us as we explore them. And that is how you know that it's alive. So as we draw to our close, our practical tips are designed to invite us into this story, to meet us in a sacred and in a new way, and to decide if our invitation to the banquet is one that we will opt into or opt out of. So your first practical tip this morning is to reimagine the story through the lens of one or more of the characters. Step into Jesus' story. Read or rewrite the story through the perspective of the host or the servant, one of the excuse makers. You can rewrite the story through the eyes and ears and lens of the crippled, the sick, the blind, or even the traveler. How do they experience this story? You can also step outside of Jesus' story into Luke's story, because this is where Luke 14 ends. We don't know what happens next. I think that's an invitation for our imagination to enter into the scriptures and to experience transformation. How did this party end? Was Jesus thrown out? Was he applauded? Did this actually break the silence, or did it take the awkward to a new level? Man, I love thinking about this. So that's your invitation. Reimagine the story. And what does God speak to you as you reimagine it? Second practical tip. At this point, the worship team can make your way back to the stage. Second practical tip, kind of thematic along this series, is to identify your story in this story. The story has many characters. And so one of the ways we can engage Scripture is try to identify how the story speaks to us. Who are we in this story? Maybe for some of us, we identify with the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. Perhaps metaphorically, where we feel that we've been limited in our access to the church. We've been limited in our access to Jesus, growing and understanding our spirituality. And maybe there's an invitation to have more. Or perhaps that's actual literal. We have people in our community that are crippled, that are legally blind, that are sick. How is this story a story of hope? A story of invitation, of participation? Maybe you identify with the people in the roads and the country lanes, or the banquet has never been on your radar. You didn't know about it, didn't care about it, but now you've been invited. And more than that, more than just the invitation, you're actually wanted. Jesus told his servant to compel them to come in. That means work at it, right? This isn't a flippant invitation, a little evite to your email. This is a please come, be here. Can you imagine your place at the table? There's the inviting servant character, and maybe this is your story, the inviting servant. Welcoming people in, being asked to do something that's unusual, odd even, and having to wrestle with a decision. Do we do this eagerly? Are we timid? What's it like to experience a story as a servant? There's also the excuse makers, and maybe this is your story as an excuse maker. Your intentions have been good, but God is pushing on your boundaries. The psalmist describes this picture of sitting at a table in the presence of his enemies. And this is a really interesting psalm because it's a good reminder that we aren't really invited to exclude people. Jesus spends a lot of work exercising this, pushing this. And so the question for you may be, who are you excluding? Who are you avoiding in your week? Are you excluding yourself? Sometimes we crank up the tunes and turn on Netflix so we're not trapped inside of our own heads. Maybe Jesus wants to meet you there. And finally, maybe your story is the story of the angry host. Kenneth Bailey, who's the author of Jesus Through Middle Eastern Eyes, describes the character's turmoil as this. The experiential realities of anger, suffering, and costly love are linked in response to the master who takes the pain of his anger and reprocesses it into grace. Part of the theology of the cross is at the heart of this transformation of anger into grace. Could this be a story about your anger? Could this be an invitation to have a more graceful posture and response? Last practical tip. Join us in communion today. Very simple one. Often called the Eucharist, communion and the Lord's Supper, the symbolism behind us drinking grape juice and eating a small piece of bread here at a church is as a reminder of our invitation to participate in the Messianic banquet. It's foreshadowing that is written into our story, and all of us are invited to the banquet. Participating in communion can be a symbol of your acceptance of the invitation, dining in the midst of religious leaders, of outcasts, and unknowns, as a sincerely welcome and wanted guest. So I'm going to invite you all to take a few minutes to close, to just reflect on the story. See how the story may speak to you. Meditate on that for a minute. See where God might be meeting you today. And then our team's going to lead us to an offering prayer, doxology, and then my friend Julius is going to come up to give instructions for our communion this morning.
As we just play in the background a bit, I just invite you, as Nigel said, to just take a few moments and let this sink in and listen to what God may want to say to you.
So now it's time to take a look at the cards that are in the seat in front of you, especially the welcome card. If you're new, please fill that out. We'd love to know who you are. And you can put any of those cards into the offering bag as it comes around. And so if you have money, please, that you can give, please do that. And you can put cash or checks into the offering bag, or you can give by credit card. We have a giving kiosk in the lobby. Or you can go to the website also and go to the Give tab. So let's take a couple of minutes and take a look at those cards and fill them out. I'm going to fill out a prayer card right now. And let's pray for the offering now. Father, thank you for the gifts that you provide for us. And we want to give some of that back to you now. Help us to trust you more as we give with open hands and expectant hearts. Please use these gifts to let the hungry be fed, the lonely be comforted, to help bless those in need. And may you be greatly trusted and praised as we give. We ask this in your name. Amen. You can remain seated as we sing the doxology right now.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above you, heavenly hosts. Praise Father, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above you, heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
With us this morning, and a special warm welcome to any of our newcomers. I want to let you know that our communion table is open to anybody and everybody, so feel free to come down as a part of our practical tip. Our communion meal, for those who are new, comes inside of a cup, with the fruit of the vine in the top cup and the bread in the bottom cup. If you require a gluten-free option, you can get that here on my right side. Just ask for that. Let us stand for communion. Heavenly Father, your great love came to dwell with us in the form of your Son, who revealed to us a Father who was created in us, and who created us, and who loves us unconditionally. Our Lord and Savior made the ultimate sacrifice and gave his life on the cross, so that through him we would have life and intimately know our eternal Father. Allow us to feel his presence all around us, within us, and in everything we do, and help us to draw closer to him daily. Our Lord Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." And so we come together at the Lord's table to receive the Lord's body, broken for our wholeness. And we drink from the cup of salvation in celebration of our acceptance and embrace our loving Father. We unite our voices and pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, power, glory, forever and ever. We come down to communion in two lanes down the center.
I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Here in your love, no place I would rather be. no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. To set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. To set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. So beautiful, no name is higher, so wonderful is Jesus' name. So beautiful, no name is higher, so wonderful is Jesus' name, is Jesus' name. And every knee will bow in heaven and the earth, and every eye will see the measure of your worth. There is no one like you, risen Son of God. Holy is your name. Holy is your name. So beautiful, no name is higher, so wonderful is Jesus. Jesus' name.
every knee will bow. Heaven and the earth, and every eye will see the measure of your worth. There is no one like you, risen Son of God. Holy is your name.
Every knee,
and every knee will bow. In heaven and the earth, and every eye will see the measure of your worth. There is no one like you, risen Son of God. Holy is your name. Holy is your name. Holy is your name. Holy is your name.
Show.
Amen. Have our benediction. Go forth, go into the world, go into these rad days of summer. Enjoy God's creation and all that he provides. Celebrate the summertime of the earth where life is enhanced by warmth and long days of sunshine. Go forth sharing, witnessing, and living the good news. Amen. Thanks, everyone. Have a great week.
Taj Mahal, Taj Mahal.